Hey friends, welcome back to the channel and another episode of How to Build an Editor with Emacs Lisp. In today's episode, I'm going to continue where we left off in the episode number 2, and we're going to talk about some of the Lisp basics. I got several questions after the previous episode, so I need to answer them. A Windows user reached out to me and asked how to install Emacs on a Windows machine. Unfortunately, I don't have enough experience with a Windows operating system, so I don't know actually how to install it on Windows, but I know it's possible, and I know there's an installer for it. Sorry, I don't know how to install it on a Windows machine, but Linux users have it easy. Almost every Linux distributions has a package for GNU Emacs. Just make sure that you install the latest one. On macOS, there's several different, I don't know what to call it, distributions of Emacs or whatever. One of them is called Aquamax. I heard good things about it, and you can install them using Homebrew. Another option is to build it from source. I personally prefer that, and I always pull master and build my own Emacs on almost monthly basis. That way I'll have all the recent changes and everything, and it's quite nice. If you know how to install Emacs on Windows or on macOS, please comment in the comment section, and it would be nice to help each other out. Another question that I got was from a friend of mine. For some reason, he's a Vim user, and I'm friends with many Vim users. But joking aside, he could, according to him, he have to, on daily basis, he has to actually run the Vim command quite a lot. In order to edit any single file, he just run a new Vim process. And obviously, he tried to use his experience with Emacs as well, tried to run Emacs for every single file, and it didn't work out. Just because he has so many libraries in his Emacs configuration, he has to pay the startup cost every time he wants to use Emacs. So he came to me and he was like, "Dude, how do you use Emacs?" I was like, "That's a weird question." And when he actually described how he uses Vim, I was like, "Oh, that makes sense," because the Emacs world and the Vim world are so different. The experience that you might have with Vim might not go well with Emacs. But to answer the question, I use just one Emacs. I use one Emacs process. I run just one Emacs instance, and I do everything in that instance. I run anything that I want in that process. I edit any project that I'm working on daily basis inside that just one Emacs, and it works great. I had no issues in past 15 years or so. But if you come from a Vim background like my friend, you might prefer that thing, right? And as I mentioned in the previous, in the first episode or the previous episode, there's literally no limit to what you can do in Emacs almost, right? So you can still do the same. You can actually use Emacs to fit your needs. In order to do that, you can actually run Emacs in the server mode and use Emacs client to connect to your server, and that would fix your problem, right? So you run Emacs in the server mode, it sits in the background doing nothing. Whenever you want to edit a file, you say Emacs client this file, Emacs client that file, and it starts Emacs in context of that server that you ran before, and you can edit your stuff and close it. You don't have to pay any extra cost for a startup. It would feel the same as you run Vim. That actually made me realize a big problem that newcomers to Emacs have to deal with. If obviously when you want to use Emacs, you have experience using other tools. My suggestion to you would be Try to think out of the box, right? If you use the same experience to create the exact same thing that you had before, especially in terms of IDEs and editors, like closed source editors, they provided some features for you and you changed yourself to use those features. So if you try to mimic what you had back then, you don't really gain anything, right? But if you try to think out of the box and step back, rethink your decisions, your requirements, it can make a huge difference. To give you an example, one thing that I did and I really liked it, that was that I tried to observe what I do during my work. I either write code or read code, right? When I work, I'm in one of these two states. While I'm writing code, obviously my hands are involved. Both of my hands are on my keyboard, and I write code, as simple as that. But when I read code, I either, like, usually I lean on my chair, or like I move back, and I use just one arm. So in order to make it easier for myself, I created a new library for my own Emacs that helps me to navigate using navigate and like issue some of the commands that I use a lot during like code reviews and while I'm reading code just with one hand, right? I have a split keyboard. So this mode helped me to just use one arm, lean back and do whatever I do with one arm, right? So I can switch between reading mode and writing mode at the same time. But no other IDE or editor can like provide this thing for me just to use, right? This is specific to me. So if you want to actually use Emacs to the fullest, I highly recommend to step back, think out of the box, and try to make everything, change everything based on your needs, to fit your needs. And basically that way you're going to enjoy your experience with Emacs much more. Another question that I got was how to evaluate forms in eLisp. I already talked about it in the previous episode, but just as a summary, one way is, like as we saw in the previous episode, is to write down your expression anywhere you want in Emacs, like literally anyway, and move your cursor to be at the end of that expression and use the key binding Control X and Control E to evaluate that. I'm going to show you, like we're going to see it in a bit. Another option is to use IELM, or I like to call it IL. I don't know what is what IELM stands for, but this is actually a wrapper for eLisp, right? You type whatever you want, and when you hit enter, it just evaluates that form. That's another one. And the last one is to use the batch mode. I'm going to show it to you today how to use the batch mode. It's quite easy to use it. It's like running like a bash script or a Python script using Python. You write some eLisp in a file and you use Emacs to evaluate it. That's it. So far in the previous episode, we talked about some of the really basic rules of Lisp. We described three rules that knowing them helps you to understand almost any Lisp, right? To some degree, not fully, right? So I'm going to summary, I'm going to go over these three rules really quick, but these three apply to almost every Lisp, not only eLisp. The first one is, in a Lisp, everything is an expression, right? So when you evaluate an expression, you get a value back, or better to say, an expression evaluates to a value. That's the first rule. The second rule is expression types evaluate usually to themselves, most of them. There are some exceptions, and those exceptions are important to us. The most important exception for the rule number two is how lists, like the Lisp data structure evaluates. So before I talk about Lisp, let's actually talk about two other exceptions. The first one is a symbol. So symbols evaluates not to themselves, to the value they point to, right? So for example, let me get a new, so for example, let's define a new variable called a, and I just hit Control X, Control E to evaluate that form, and I defined a new variable. I'm going to talk about variables in a bit, but for now, I defined a new variable called A, right? A on its own is a symbol. When I try to evaluate A, what happens is Emacs is going to actually look for a value that has the name tag A, right? So instead of saying variables, I like to say I created a new binding, a name binding here. I bound name A to value number one, right? So when I evaluate symbol A, it tries to find the binding that the name is A in my current scope. If it finds it, it retains the value, and that value would be the result of evaluation of A. If it doesn't find any value, like if I try to evaluate B, I get an error saying void variable B. So B is not defined. That's how symbols evaluate in Lisp. Another one that is different is obviously list, which is the most important data structure in a Lisp. First of all, if you're new to any Lisp, you might find it kind of terrifying to look at any like a Lisp code. Let me actually show you some real world Lisp code, right? When you look at this, you would be like, what's up with all the parentheses? As we discussed in the previous episode, when you want to like create a Lisp in Emacs, not in Emacs, in any Lisp, you use parentheses. So whatever that comes in between these two parentheses are just different elements of just one Lisp, one list, sorry. So this list here has set face attribute as the first element, a symbol called default as a second. I'm going to talk about this code here in a bit, but then the third element is T, symbol T, and keyboard font and symbol font, right? But the thing is, when you want to evaluate a Lisp, as we discussed in the previous episode, let's say something like this. Right? When we want to evaluate this list, what happens is Emacs will actually evaluate only the first element. The result of evaluation of message, which is a symbol, is a function called message, right? So we talked about it. Lisp tried to find the binding that the name is message, and if there is a binding with such name, it returns the value. And in our case, the value is function message. And if the first element evaluates to a function, then Lisp goes walks the list and evaluate every single element. So in our case, it's going to evaluate this string in here and then this list as well, that on its own is just another function call. And it's going to replace the result of those evaluations with their values. So a string evaluates to itself, and this function call evaluates to number 3. And finally, it calls function message with these two parameters as function parameters, right? And as you can see, prints out number 3 on bottom left, and again, number 3. That's the whole like that's how lists are like usually evaluates in, not usually always evaluate in any Lisp. And one other exception. There's more exceptions, but we're going to talk about them in the future. And the other one is quote, right? Single quote or function quote. They're the same basically. The single quote is like the shorthand version of function code. Whatever you pass to code, it's going to return it, like return that value. It doesn't evaluate anything, right? So if I pass the same list in here, instead of evaluating it, it's going to actually return the list itself. So that's the way we usually define a list. We just use a single quote, again, an equivalent to quote, and we just describe our list. That's it, right? So for now, these three exceptions are fine. Let's continue. Like we learned about all this in the previous episode, but since they're really important, I wanted to make sure that we got it covered. I'm going to continue with the Lisp basics for like few episodes because it's important to know the language before we can actually jump to creating our own editor, right? So the new concept that I'm going to talk about today is variable. So like many other programming languages, Lisp has variables as well. Not every Lisp has the concept of variables. For example, Clojure doesn't. Everything is immutable in Clojure, like a functional style. But older Lisps usually have variables. Lisp being like an old Lisp, it does actually have variables. How to define variables and constants? So one thing to remember, as you can see here, I just described a variable like this. In another like programming language, compared to other programming languages, like let's say I don't know, Python, for example, this line would be something like this. It would be an assignment, right? You don't have to define A in advance. That applies to Lisp as well, but there's a huge but. And if you use Lisp just to script something, that's fine. But if you want to use the native compiler and everything, and if you want to do it right, you need to define the variable in advance. How to do that is to use, sorry, is to use a special form called defvar. Defvar, as you can see on the bottom left, you can see the signature. It gets a symbol, an optional init value, and doc string. So if I say, let's use another name. If I say defvar x, I define the variable x, but with no value, right? But I want my x variable has an initial value 100, and then I might like to give it like a doc string. Say x is just a variable, right? So doing this is the actual and the right way to define variables in Emacs Lisp. The other way would have been to say set q x1, which exactly translates to a equals 1, right? But always use a defvar, and I'm going to talk about scopes in Lisp in like a few minutes. Every variable that you define using defvar is a global variable, even if you define it in a function, right? It shocks some of like when if you're new to Lisp, it's going to kind of mess with your head a little bit because you don't like. I don't know any other language that by default every variable is global, right? So every variable that you define with defvar is a global variable. And that statements include the set Q as well. So For example, if I create a function, I'm going to talk about functions in a bit as well. If I create a function called x1 and inside of it I do set q y3 y4, and when I evaluate, like when I call this function, I like defines and like I set a new global variable called y with the value 4, right? It's not local to the function. Set q and def1 and everything is going to make global variables. By default, variables are global in a Lisp. And there's another special form called, actually it's, I don't know whether it's a special form or not, called defconst, which define a constant. We can say z, for example. Z is a constant. And as the name suggests, defconst, we use defconst to define like constant values. We tell Emacs that name z, or it's wrong to call them variable, or that constant z never changes. Its value is 3 and that's it. We're not going to change it ever again. I talked about how to set a value, how to set the value of a variable, and global and local scope. Also lexical binding versus dynamic binding. So these two bullet points by themselves shocks many, many like people who actually start using Lisp, any Lisp, right? Actually, the second one is ELISP specific, but the first one is in every Lisp. So let's start fresh. Again, I have a function called fun blah. In this function, I set the value of foo to bar, right? I define the function, and again, I use Control X, Control E, as you can see on the right side, to evaluate that form, basically to define the function. When I call that function from the previous episode and earlier in this episode, we know that when we try to evaluate a list, it finds, it tries to evaluate the first element, which in this case is a function. Sorry. And then if it was a function, evaluate the rest of the parameters and call the function with those parameters. So when I evaluate this function, right, it returns bar. That's, there's a reason for it. We're going to talk about it in a bit. But basically, from that moment in time, I defined a variable called foo. As you can see, I'm calling, like I'm evaluating foo outside of my blah function, and I still get the value of it. So that was like, that's an example of what I told you earlier. Every variable in a Lisp is global, but you can have local variables. In order to have local variables, you can use something like let, a special form called let, right? So right now I created a new variable called x and with one as the value, but it's local to that let only. Whatever form I provide here is going to use one as the value of x. I'm going to talk about let in the near future, but for now, to kind of demonstrate the difference between global and local scope in a Lisp, that's enough. Also, this one is like a shock to many newcomers, but one other thing that totally was a shock for me, and you might come across it earlier than you think, is lexical binding versus dynamic binding. So in any other programming language that you use, even different like other Lisps. Usually, at least I don't know any other language that uses dynamic bindings. But Emacs by default uses dynamic bindings. And the other side of the coin is lexical binding. Almost every other language that I know uses lexical bindings. So when you come across the dynamic bindings, it might kind of be really strange to you. It might sound a little bit complicated, but it's better to know it right now rather than be surprised in the future. To show you how dynamic binding works, I created just like a really stupid a stupid example. Let's say we have a function called b, and in it we return a value we return the value of symbol AAA, right? We didn't define symbol AAA yet, and when after we define that function, we're going to call it inside of a let a special form. I'm going to talk about let quite a lot in probably next episode or in next two episodes at least. But for now, let's say we define AAA with number 300, and we call B inside that let. So when we call this B here, AAA is already defined, right? So I save this file and let's give it a shot. I'm going to show you how to use Emacs in batch mode. So we can just write Emacs NW. By the way, NW runs Emacs in terminal, right? Ooh, that was a big mistake. Yep, that was a big mistake. Anyway, let me actually. Yes, kill it and run it again. Yeah, Emacs dash NW runs Emacs in terminal mode. And we pass dash Q just to avoid loading any other files that Emacs usually do on a startup, just because we don't need them. We want to run Emacs as the interpreter only in the batch mode. And I guess we need batch and dash L x.el. So the batch parameters tell Emacs that, yeah, I want to run in the batch mode, and dash L is like load this file for me, and we pass it the file that we got, right? We got number 300 printed on the screen, right, as the output. But if we go back to the file and look at it closely, if it was another programming language like Python, for example, you would have said def b and then return AAA, right? But what is AAA? You didn't define it anywhere. You should have get a error saying that, yeah, I don't know anything about AAA, AAA. But instead, we got number 300 back, like printed. So this let returns 300, which is the value of AAA here when we call B. This is dynamic binding, and this is really confusing if you're new, if it's new to you. So what happens is when you use dynamic binding, your scope would be defined in the place that you call the function, rather than you define the function. So AAA here doesn't have any meaning, but when you use it in like a context, when you use it in a scope that has AAA available, then that AAA makes sense, right? But in the other hand, we have lexical scopes that we used to from other programming languages. So I turned on lexical scopes and lexical bindings, and if I try to run it again, yeah, as we expected, we get an error saying, yeah, we don't know, I don't know anything about AAA. So basically, my suggestion is to always turn on lexical binding no matter what. because if you want to do functional programming or functional style programming, or create closures or lambdas or whatever, you kind of need lexical binding. I mean, if you want to define them in a way that you're used to, you want lexical binding. So my suggestion to you is to always turn it on. How do you turn it on? You either need to set the value directly like this, right? Set the value of lexical binding to true in every buffer you have. By the way, this is like a local buffer, local variable. So each buffer has its own value for lexical binding. So you might have two buffers. One has lexical binding, the other has dynamic binding. That's totally possible. So in order to avoid all that, it's better to use this thing, this comment here. Semicolons are the character to mark a new comment, like a comment line in Lisp. And by doing this, when we put this in a header of any file, dash, asterisk, dash, and the name of the variable followed by a colon and the value and semicolon to kind of mark the end, like the ending of an assignment. We can put another variable here with another value, right? But for now, we have just one variable. What happens is when Emacs reaches to that point, it automatically set the value of lexical binding to true. That's how you actually turn on lexical binding for your buffer. And as I mentioned, I highly recommend you to do it for every buffer because that's what you used to in other programming languages. So it was just a heads up because I'm pretty sure if you want to play around with functions that I'm going to talk about right now, you might end up in this situation. If you try to pass functions and call them later, blah, 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 you see some crazy stuff that you're not used to. That's due to the fact that by default dynamic bindings is on and you want lexical binding. Anyway, and the last topic of the day is functions and how to define them, functions versus macros and special forms. You already saw how we can actually define a function. As always, everything starts with a list. We define a new list that the first element is a special form called define. I tell you why it's called a special forms in a little bit, but for now, let's have it in as it is, right? Then we have to come up with a name. We use a symbol as a name. Let's call it test one. And a list of parameters, an optional docker string, like describe your function, like a small documentation for your function. Whatever you write here, for example, let's say we write test, like the worst docker string ever, right? And then the function body. The function body can be as many form as you want. We can say, for example, 1 plus 2, message something, and finally 4, right? The result of the evaluation of the final form in the function body would be the result, the return value of that function. In this example, number 4 would be the return value of our function. So when I define this one, I can call it normally. And as you can see on the bottom left, I got number 4 back as the return value. So basically this region here that I'm marking right now is the function body of our function. But I define this function, right? If I do control H F, I can search for any function to see the documentation for it, right? And Surprise, surprise, we have our function listed in this list as well. Let's see our documentation. As you can see on in this buffer, the buffer on the bottom, we have test, test, test. That was our doc string. So writing a doc string is really useful, especially when we want to kind of create a library for other users to use. So it's like super useful to have the doc string. I usually write them for every function that I use, and I recommend you to do the same as well. There's some rules for the doc string, and you're going to set up Emacs in the future in a way that let you know how to write a proper doc string. But for now, this is fine. One other thing regarding to the naming convention of the functions. So ELISP doesn't have any concept like namespaces or stuff like that. Whatever function name that you use is global in your entire Emacs instance. So right now I created a function called test1. If I use a library somewhere, if I load a library that has a function test1 as well, they're going to clash, right? There's no namespace in Emacs Lisp. And that's one of the things that I don't like about ELISP, but the fact is it's pretty old. Back then it was a norm, and it's really hard to change it after like 40 years or something. So in order to kind of get around that, people came up with some different conventions to use for the function's name. So the common one that you find on the internet is that when you create a library, let's say we have a library called blue here. Our library name is blue. When you want to create a function, you kind of use the blue prefix with a dash for your function name. So blue dash test1 means that, yeah, this is the function test1 from blue library. So to call it, you would say blue test1, right? That's a convention. If you want to use a private function, there's no such thing as a private function, but to mark functions as private, we use two dashes. That's a common known naming convention in ELISP, but personally, I don't like that. I like to use a slash instead to kind of separate the namespace than from the name. And then if I want to use, if I want to mark my function as being private, there's no private really, but it's my way to kind of tell the user that, hey, this is private, don't mess around with it. I use two dashes, either after the name or before the name, depends wherever I need the dash, right? And the same is just dash base, blue/test1 in my convention means blue is the namespace and test1 is the function name. But the fact is both of them are the function name. So know about this before you read any, knowing this before you read any code would be kind of more useful to you. This is how we define functions, and you already know about how to call functions. But how does it, what's the difference between a function and a macro and a special? So let's say we have a function with two parameters, x and y, right? And I want to do this, right? I want to do kind of sum them together in a weird way. Not a weird way, but whatever. If I want to call this function, I can do something like this, 2 and 3, and the result, I forgot to reevaluate it. And the result is 7, right? And I can replace this number 3 here with another expression, right? As you can see, number 11 is the result. But what happens here is that as soon as ELISP actually evaluates the first element and knows that test one is a function. It goes and evaluates every single elements in that list. It evaluates number two, it's a number, it evaluates to itself, it's a value on its own. It tries to evaluate this list in here, which is a function call. It finds a function plus and then pass 3 and 4 to it, replace it with the result, and finally, when every single element in the list are evaluated and the value is known, pass everything to the function test one. That's how functions work. But in compared to that, one other really important aspect of a function is that functions operate on runtime. Right now, this function, when I evaluate it, it happens in the runtime. There's a compile time as well. I'm going to talk about compile times, compile time versus runtime when I want to talk about macros in the future. They're kind of advanced topic. It doesn't make sense to talk about them in depth right now. But the difference is when we invoke a macro, when we call a macro, it happens in the compile time. And unlike functions, let me create a macro here. It's just like a super easy macro, right? And when I call blah here with something like this expression, when I call blah here, right? As soon as ELISP figures out that, okay, blah is a macro, instead of evaluating the rest of the elements, it doesn't do anything. It calls macro blah and passes whatever elements are left in the list as its parameters. So it doesn't evaluate the parameters, and at the same time, it happens in the compile time. I'm going to talk about compile time in the future. The same concept applies to special forms as well. Special forms are those forms that the standard evaluation strategy, the way that Lisp evaluates lists, doesn't apply to them. That's why we call it a special form. The most common special forms is if. So if takes three parameters. The first one is a condition. I'm going to talk about it in the next episode in details, but it gets a parameter. Let's say X, for example. Do we have X? No. Let's say T, right? And the second parameter is just one expression. Let's say 3. And finally, the last one would be another expression. The second expression the way if evaluates is that it evaluates the first parameter. So the T here stands for true. If that condition was true, then it's going to evaluate the second one, the second parameter. If it wasn't, it's going to evaluate the final parameters, right? So this is like if was a function, calling if like this would have caused 3 and 4 to be evaluated, right? So if we had a expression here to write to a file, right? Write to a file, for example. And we had delete a file, right? If the keyword if was a function, what would have happened was that every single element in this list would have been evaluated by ELISP, and then if would have been called, right? Which wouldn't be good, right? Like write to a file and then delete a file, if and else together. That doesn't make sense. That's why if and other special forms has a different evaluation strategy. Like in terms of the if special form, it evaluates the condition. If it was true, runs the first or then clause. And if it wasn't true, run the else clause, right? That's how it evaluates the parameters. And that's why we call them special forms. But that's it. That's enough for now. Today, we just learned about some how to define variables, how to set the value, the difference between global and local scope, and lexical bindings versus dynamic bindings, and how to define functions. In the next episode, we're going to talk about some of the special forms, especially those around conditionals, and continue our journey in Lisp basics. That's it for today. If you find my work interesting, please consider subscribing to the channel and leave a like. It would help me a lot, especially with my other projects like the Serine compiler. I would love to hear about your feedback on the video series and the project itself. Thanks for watching and see you in the next episode.